degree from here to here to here is very similar. So we have a new kind of frequency that we think of. So here is now a limit, a limit, and a limit, so it's three limits, and we need to generate a new little limit, which is r to n squared. Now you might say, well, why don't we go back earlier? And this was not the first limit, that was the first limit. But the point is, this was the first limit after this limit of limits. So we got the limit of limits, and then we kind of erase the space and start again back where we were. And then this is the next limit after this limit of limits, then another limit here, and then another limit here, and we use those three to create a sequence which has limits, this one here. So this is another limit of limits. So then we could create a successor, and a dissuccessor, and a dissuccessor, and then the limits of these ones would be star 2 n squared plus n. So we're kind of getting into a group here, and let me just make some observations about the pattern that we're trying to establish here. That successor operations follow commas. So if you have an operation in equal just in front of the end of a comma, then that's telling you that this operation is a successor. It's a successor of the one that's previously to the left of that comma. Limit operations follow arrows. So if you look at some operation that has an arrow in front of it, that's telling you that that's a limit operation. cell. This forlorn axon, which sends out information to make connections with thousands of other cells. The information is processed and comes into dendrites. It is aggregated with the cell body and it communicates that certain information thousands of times at one time. So they're not all the same. This is just a small sampling of different types of neurons that exist in the brain. Each one of them has a separate function. You can see these different types of processing. There are different lengths of their axon. And so they can communicate information at different rates. So this look at the individual cell is played out in the fact that there are different structures of the brain that have subserve different functions, so it's not fully distributed throughout the brain, but as an envision, there's certain substructures with pathways that are used for processing information from the eye through the optic tract onto the lateral geniculate through the optic radiations into the visual cortex where processing occurs, or human processing occurs. So even in the visual system, that area of the cortex is broken up into smaller subunits, each with specialized units of information, compartmentalizing information, but integrating the information just about vision. That same sort of today we exist for the somatosensory system, touching, where in the cortex, known as somatosensory cortex, there's what's called a homunculus, where distributed information is processed about how we interact and how we feel and touch our environment. This is also displayed here in a pseudo diagram of that somatosensory cortex, showing the different areas of the cortex that respond selectively to individual touches. We don't think of this as a process, a machine, we understand each one of the critical elements of it, but the dynamic of part of this comes from the fact that there are what are called critical periods. And critical periods are phases in life in which you understand with a heightened sensitivity from exogenous stimulation that are compulsory for the development of particular skills. A good example is that man's brain processes visual information actually developed after birth. So the way we perceive the world, to a certain extent, determined by those things that we experience in the early stages of our life, visually. Likewise, language. For a few years of life constitutes time period during language. Certainly, as usually before 5 years of age is a very important feature. This is exaggerated in the case where certain countries that don't hear, for example, in Japan, are in hell before the 18th month of age, will never be able to make that distinction. So the brain needs to have these experiences in order for it to be able to respond later. These are called critical periods, and these are the areas of most structural plasticity that occurs in the brain. And the brain develops in utero here just from the last 8 months and then right at the time of birth. And that will build up. The brain expands even further. So it's not just that you're rewiring things, the brain is actually expanding dramatically from the period of just up to these postnatal periods. The expansion of the cortex is really quite impressive. And I must say, we don't really understand the nature of that expansion, how much of that is connections, how much of that is increased myelination, continues to occur later in life. The synaptic pruning, and in some cases, even the birth of neurons. That's one of the things that I'll tell you a little bit about. One of our heroes in neuroscience is Monica Hall, and he addresses issues of structural plasticity and how fixed the brain is postnatally, and that once development is ended, the process of growth and regeneration of axons dried up, the centers are fixed and mutable. I should take a moment to say that this is true with regard to the techniques that we currently have, and that as technology develops, we may in fact, prove me wrong. Over the last 15 or so years, it's been clear that there are areas, very few areas, but there are areas in the brain that are do add new neurons, even. Not just new cells and connections, but add new neurons over time. I'll tell you a little bit about that. One of the areas is a brain structure called the hippocampus, which is a part of the learning memory. And one of those future states is part of the words expert on memory, which is probably one of the most important functions for our ability to grasp our environment. So in this area, the hippocampus receives information from the sensory and the motor cortex into the hippocampus where it's aggregated through a defined circuitry. And that information, that olfactory information, emotional information, visual information, is aggregated into what we think of as memory, and memory then stored in some distributed way in the cortex for future study. We believe the formation of that memory of the different sensory modalities and experiences that occurs within the circuit. So it's in that circuit, at the first stage of the circuit, period. So with this shape require stimulation to achieve full maturity. And then this type of nourishment system for the brain is something that occurs all species from little to children. And we know that it's regulated by experience, so environmental changes.